Hey guys, welcome to all of you on our channel, that is the Chief IAS. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are targeting the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So in this video we will be discussing about our series, in which what we do, we daily solve some questions for prelims 2020. So we have named this series as let's cover some questions for prelims 2020. So as is clear from its name, so this series is not just about solving questions but also about your participation. So we will certainly appreciate if you make participation in this video, and we request you to please update any additional information if you have in the comment box. So you will be certainly welcomed. So let's start our discussion, friends. Video number is 19. So today we will be going to discuss the questions from the polity section. So let's see what are the questions. First question is, consider the following about the role of International Court of Justice. First, only states are eligible to appear before the court. No private entity can move ICJ. Second is, it provides individuals and groups with legal counseling and helps them deal with the authorities of any state in major human rights violation situations. Third is, it is final appellate court for decisions passed by major international tribunals. So we have to choose the correct answer. So let me tell you, friends, that only one statement is correct, and that is first statement. So the answer is A, one only. So about International Court of Justice, that is, the court has no jurisdiction to deal with applications from individuals or NGOs or corporations or any other private entity. So only states are eligible to appear before the court, and it cannot provide them with the legal counseling or help them in their dealings with the authorities of any state, whatever. So then also, the court is not a supreme court to which national courts can turn. It does not act as a court of last resort for individuals. And learning is that, however, state may take up the case of one of its nationals and invoke against the state the wrongs which its national claims to have suffered at the hands of later. The dispute then becomes one between states. So you might be aware of the case of Kulbhushan Yadav, which is currently in the realm of International Court of Justice. So here, though the person involved is individual, but now it has become a dispute between India and Pakistan. The court can only hear a dispute when requested to do so by one or more states. So it cannot deal with a dispute on its own motion. So it cannot take a suo motu cognizans. So it is not permitted under its statute to investigate and rule on acts of sovereign states as it chooses. So the states concerned must also have access to the court and have accepted its jurisdiction. So in other words, if you, for example, India is moving to International Court of Justice or Pakistan is moving to International Court of Justice, then both the countries must have accepted its jurisdiction. So it is not that one state has accepted and the other hasn't, and then one of the states can move, one of the states that is party to dispute can move to the court. So there is this is a fundamental principle that governs the settlement of international disputes. So states being sovereign and free to choose the methods of resolving their disputes. Judgment delivered by the court in disputes between states are binding upon the parties concerned, and also judgments are final and without any appeal. So if either of the party challenges their scope or meaning, it has the option to request an interpretation. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, which of the following is our fundamental rights provided by the Constitution of India? First, no person shall be deprived of his property save by the authority of law. Second, all linguistic and religious minorities shall have the right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. So we have to choose the correct answer. So this is quite easy question, friends. Answer is B, that is second only. Right to property is no longer a fundamental right. It is basically a constitutional right that is under Article 300 of of Indian Constitution, but it has no longer it has been no longer this fundamental right. So straight it is a legal right only and was stripped of its status as a constitutional right long back. And these are a statement two is that this the right which has been there in statement two, it is basically part of minority rights under the broader framework of Article 25 to 30 that protect religious rights, safeguard minorities and their culture and heritage. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, which of the following terms have not been defined in the Constitution? A, union territory. B, securities. C, agricultural income. D, procedure established by law. So let me tell you friends, the answer is D, that is procedure established by law is not defined under the Constitution. So Article 366 contains the definition of various provisions, definition of various terms that are used in different provisions. So these are mentioned below. For example, agricultural income means income as defined for the purposes of the enactments relating to Indian income tax, and then securities include stock. And union territory means union territory specified in the first schedule and includes any other territory comprised within the territory of India but not specified in that schedule. So since the term procedure established by law is not defined, the courts have taken enough liberty to interpret it to mean due process of law. So you might be aware of the fact that only earlier it was said that India is a country that has procedure established by law. That is, in it due process is not followed, but from time to time the Supreme Court has made various interpretations in which it has substantively changed the meaning of procedure established by law to include due process of law as well. So now let's move to the next question. Next is the term of Rajya Sabha. Can be extended by an extraordinary presidential order, can be extended by 6 months at a time by ordinary legislation, can be extended by 1 year at a time during the proclamation of emergency, D, none of the above. So friends, the answer is D, none of the above. So basically Rajya Sabha is a permanent house, so obviously then there is no question of extending its term. So it has no term, it remains there permanently. So it is the term of MPs of the house basically, and not of the Rajya Sabha. So D can be the only answer. So Lok Sabha terms can be increased by 6 months at a time during the proclamation of emergency. So this is keeping in view the importance of legislature overseeing the actions of the executive during emergency period. So now let's move to the next question. Next is, as per the present arrangements, appointment committee of the cabinet includes A, Prime Minister and Minister of Home Affairs only, B, Prime Minister, Minister of Home Affairs, Minister of Finance, Minister of External Affairs, Minister of Defence, C, Prime Minister, Minister of Home Affairs, Minister of Finance, Minister of External Affairs, Minister of Urban Development and Minister of Corporate Affairs, D, Prime Minister and all cabinet ministers. So friends, we have to choose the correct answer. Let me tell you friends that this appointment committee includes Prime Minister and Minister of Home Affairs only. So the answer is A. So there are only two members in the appointments committee of the cabinet, that is PM and then MOHA. So this is today's discussion friends. So out of 5 questions, if you have scored 3 to 5 marks, then it is good. But if you have scored 0, 1, 2, then at least it is very much good, because at least you have seen come across some new facts and concepts which you were earlier not aware. So why I talked about scores, because mostly students have the habit to count the scores and they think that if they have scored 0 or 1 or 2 or 3 they are not performing well. But my question is that at least in the beginning of the preparation, don't count your scores. At least see the questions as a source of learning, see the explanations as a source of learning. So you might be reading books, there might be no lethargy on your part in terms of reading, but you, if you don't solve questions, then certainly your marks will be less. But that should not discourage you, but because in the beginning you have to see these questions as practice questions through which you can improve your information about the subject. So it is my request that don't count these scores, because if you start counting scores, then you will stop seeing these videos, which will be much harmful for you people. Because ultimately, if you see this as a source of learning, then you will be seeing these daily videos. And as we post them daily, and we will continue to post them until your prelims 2020. So you will be seeing these videos daily, and you will be learning a lot of things. So do ensure that you see these videos and improve your score. Don't just focus upon on just checking how much score you are getting or not. So this is the way of perceiving things. And also, friends, as you might be aware, that we on this platform have multiple series for the purpose of CSE preparation. For example, we have Indian Polity series, in which we are covering M. Lakshmikant's book in 60 days. And then also we have that Modern India based series, in which we cover your Spectrum Publications book. And there are other NCERT series, for example, History, Geography, and Art and Culture. So if in case you are interested to cover those topics, then do ensure that you join our series. The link of these series is available in the description box. So these series ensure that you cover your syllabus in a time-bound manner, because most of the students these days, they prepare from home and they are not in urban areas to take coaching. So they lack self-discipline and in their preparation. So this problem of few people is solved by us, because here we provide you a kind of time-bound framework in which you will have to complete your syllabus. So if in case you are interested to join, then you can check the link in the description box. The link of Indian Polity is shown on your screen, and all the other links, and including that of Polity, is there in the description box. So friends, this is all about today's video. And lastly, we also have a Telegram channel where we have more than 15,000 subscribers, and we share various public resources for the purpose of CSE preparation in that Telegram channel. So if in case you are interested to get access to those resources, and in case you are interested to get the PDFs of these discussions as well, then do ensure that you join our Telegram channel, where we will post the PDFs of the discussions. So link is there in the description box. So do ensure that you check the description box. So this is all about today's video. Do ensure that you subscribe to our channel. So thank you, friends. Have a very nice day ahead.